Good evening. It's Sunday the 9th of... oh, am I with you? 1 minute. Oh, there we are. Yes, it's Sunday the 9th of April 2017. A very good evening to you. Welcome to one of these rather rare now late night programmes here. It's United Kingdom Talk, Chris Weird with you for the next hour or so, boys and girls. Hope you're well today. I didn't do a show this morning or this afternoon. I just guessed you'd be out in the sunshine as I was. Oh, it was so nice today, but you'll notice it tomorrow. Oh, God, we're going down like 10, 12 degrees tomorrow, which isn't like freezing cold. It'd be like, you know, about sort of in the 60s. But you'll certainly notice the difference from today. So be warned about that. Coming up in the show today, boys and girls, a petition. A petition which you may well want to sign. Don't know if you will. That's coming up in the show. A Ryanair story. We've got some real complaints sent in by Thomas Cook customers who have been on holiday there. And, of course, a few stories from me. You on the phone as well. If you want to call in at some point, you're welcome to do so, boys and girls. I'll open the phone lines now, actually. Let's open the phone line. All right, 020-8144-3477 is my phone number, OK? 020-8144-3477. I've changed a bit of software in front of me and it's really confusing me. So I think I just go back to what it was. Hang on a minute, I can do that by just clicking that. That's better. I know what I'm doing now. Sometimes you change these. You know, you get sort of used to how something works and then you change it. It's a bit like software, isn't it? It's a bit like software. You know, for ages and ages, take a good example is Facebook website. So you use it and then they change. So, oh, where's that go? Oh, I can't stand it. I can't stand change. Is that an age thing, do you think? Could it be an age thing? We're going to start off today with some stories then, boys and girls, about the complaints received by Thomas Cook holidaymakers. OK, that's what we'll start off with on the show tonight. Let's say hello to a few people who are with us early. Good evening to Jerry Millen up nice and I say it's late. It's only 9:45 at night. Hello. Hello to Jerry. Rod Brown's with us. Gustav says, evening, my darlings. It's a late night special. Have just cracked open a second bottle of White Lightning. Yeah, that's your sort of thing, isn't it? Did you pop into Aldi earlier and get to a few bottles of those? Gustav, I have to tell you, drinks all this cheap booze. He does. Honestly, he comes into the places I work at in the worst clothes you've ever seen. Old tracksuit bottoms and things like that. You know, which look nice on someone who's sort of in their early 20s. But at Gustav's age, it's kind of not doing it, really. And don't think I don't know you bring in your own bottle of White Lightning when I'm out working somewhere. I've seen that old Aldi carrier bag that you bring to various places. You know, he asks for a glass of tap water, doesn't he? Asks for a glass of tap water. And then every few minutes, every half hour or so, he disappears into the toilet and comes out, strangely enough, with a full glass of cider. Hasn't that strange? That's very strange. Good evening to Alan Russell. Hope you had a good weekend. Yeah, it's been very nice, Alan. Very, very relaxing. I've got to say, after a little sleep tonight, I got up and I was just so totally relaxed. I was watching the telly, Benidorm and all. Oh, I love Benidorm, don't you? Good evening to Josh. Hello, Josh, who's in Sartiano in the south of Italy. Ciao! Ciao! Which is in the region of Tuscany. The weather's been lovely, but no beach, sadly. I wouldn't miss a beach, to be honest. I like looking at the sea. I don't mind a pebble beach. I don't like sandy beaches. That sand gets everywhere. Oh, it's in between your toes. Even when there's like a tap somewhere, you wash it out, or you wash it under the tap, and as soon as you put it back down in your flip-flop or something like that, the sand is back in between. I hate sand, so I don't miss a beach, to be honest. A pebble beach is okay. I think Pebble Beach, they got a pebble beach in Brucklesham Bay, where I used to go as a child a lot. It's not too far from Bognor Regis, that. I'm watching this an hour ahead. Oh, right, so it's 10:45 at night there. So this is your bedtime story, isn't it? You see, I'm like an uncle now. Well, I am an uncle, as you know. I'm a great uncle. I'm a great uncle. I'm just like an uncle reading you a bedtime story. Hello, children, and what would you lead like today? Today's little bedtime story is The Shining. Nothing better than seeing a child scared out witless because of something you've just done. All right, Josh, I tried most of the amazing pizza tonight, which has been the highlight of my holiday. I love pizza. My favourite pizza, I have to say, is Domino's, but I don't eat it much because I think we're totally... Oh, I've just found my Tesco's club card. Look at that. Because I think they're horrendously expensive, Domino's pizzas. And even like the Tuesday for Tuesday or something like that, when you get two for the price of one, and one comes to like 16 quid. Hello? And that's a two-for-one offer, is it? 16 quid. You know you can go up the supermarket and get... Actually, Aldi. Now, what was the make? Goodman's or good cooking, something like that. But Aldi do a box of three... I think it's three pizzas, reasonable size. And there's something ridiculous like £2.20 for three pizzas. They are absolutely delicious. They really are. I've tried the ones at Sainsburys, the freshly prepared ones, and they're really doughy. I mean, no, I wouldn't be having another one of those. You put them in the oven, and when you take it out, the cheese was so bloody thin on top that it's just, like, gone crispy. And it's like, whoa, it's like, oh, not nice, those Sainsburys fresh pizzas. But highly recommended, actually, are the Aldi ones that are frozen. I'll pop in there maybe tomorrow or the day after, and I'll see if I can find some, and I'll tell you which what make they. Or maybe you've tried them yourself. Anyone know what those ones are? It doesn't say Aldi or anything like that. I think it starts good something, good cooking, good man, something like that. Three pizzas for about £2.50 or ridiculous, and they are really nice, really really nice. So they're the pizzas I like. Domino's, yes, if I'm having a takeout, but very rare because they're so damn expensive. You know. Hello to Lee Cobby. Hello, Lee, who says, good evening. Looking forward to another great show. Are we sunburnt? No, but look at my tan, boy. Oh, yeah. Look at this, man. I'm very lucky in the sun. It's very rare that I burn. Literally 10 minutes of sun and bang, I'm brown again. I'm sure I was possibly black in the last life. And there's still some nice blackness in my blood, which is making me tan very easily. I should be grateful. I should be very grateful for that. What about you, Lee? Are you a tanner or a burner? That's the question. Are you a Bunsen burner? Do you remember those at school, Bunsen burners? Bunsen burners at school. Hello to Daniel. Good evening, Daniel, in Camberley. Elaine's with us in Israel. Good evening, Chris, everyone. I'm on the train home after meeting my good friend after my show tonight. Oh, I hope you had a good show, Elaine. I hope you had a lovely time, darling. Getting used to it now, are you? Elaine does her own show on a radio station in Israel. Hoping to meet up with Elaine in the next year or so. I do hope so, anyway. Probably next year it'll be Elaine, all right? James Clark is with us tonight. Hello, James. Good evening. First evening show as well. Will this be a regular occurrence this summer? I don't know, James, really. As you know, I don't schedule the shows at all. I just do as and when. I try and do like a little warning video, sort of half an hour, 20 minutes before I do a show to let you know there's one starting. But sometimes, I mean, I'll be honest with you. This morning I did that little thing from the garden. While I was topless, boys and girls. It's not a nice sight. There was a lovely, lovely sight walking towards Sainsbury's today with no top on, he had. Oh, he was gorgeous, dear. And he was swinging his bum left and right with his little T-shirt hanging out at the top. Oh, it was gorgeous. I had to sit down for 5 minutes once the security man in Sainsbury's had to help me into a chair. Oh, I've come over all faint, I have. No, I don't really... I used to look like that. I did. Yes, I did. That 20 years ago it was, when I was 32. 22 years. Once it's gone. Nothing you can do about it. That's the way it is. Accept your age gracefully. That's what you have to do. James. So I never know, really. And I must be honest, when I was doing... I did the little video today and I put the phone down and sat in the garden reading. But I'm reading a new book now. I haven't got it with me, so I can't tell you about it. Maybe on the next show I'll tell you about it. Then after that, I did some stuff, which I'll tell you about it later on. I want to do some stories first. and came back, went to bed, got up. I actually didn't feel like doing it again tonight. You know, I do now. Now I've started and I'm chatting to you. I'm fine. I feel great. I feel fantastic. But I got up, had something to eat, and then watched the telly, watched a bit of Benidorm. And I thought, oh, do you know, I don't want to do this now. I can't be bothered to do it. But I'm glad I have done, because I think you can fall into that I can't be bothered to do anything type thing, you know, and I don't think that's good for anyone. I really don't. But regular occurrence this summer, I never know, James. I just do as and when, as you well know. Or normally one a day. Not quite one a day, but normally one a day. There won't be a show tomorrow because I'm very busy tomorrow, OK? Good afternoon. Good evening to Dean. Dean's with us today. Kevin Webster. Mary Warren says, I hope you had a beautiful weekend. It's been fantastic, Mary. Such a nice time. Tanya Sheridan is with us this evening. Hello, Tanya. Matt Gardner, not too far away from me in Woking. He's been cooking tonight. You'd done a curry or something, didn't you? Didn't you, Matt? I hope your curry was successful. Hello, Matt. Lovely Matt's with us. Nice to have you back from your holiday. Damo's there. Hello, Damo. He likes the shirt. Thank you, I don't know what make this is. Anyone know? Hold on a minute. Gustav says, I wear High Street very well. I don't know what he means by that. That's the emblem. It's like a... I don't know what that is. It's like an eagle. Oh, I can't even see it. Just a minute now. What is it? I'm there. Is it an eagle? Can you see that? It's an eagle. I don't know what make this is. Do you want me to take it off and have a look for you? No, you don't. Honestly, you don't want to see that. You really don't want to see that. David Jackson's with us. Good evening, David. Who likes the new background? Well, it has been like that for a few months now, David. Where have you been? Huh? What's the point of me doing things up? No one notices for like 3 months. It's been like that for about 3 months, David. Do try and keep up with us, dear. Honestly, come on, chop chop, dear. Keep up with us. James says, how much did Tesco pay you to plug them? Nothing, unfortunately. This programme is not sponsored, but if you want to sponsor it, James, feel free to do so. It doesn't have to be cash. You can sponsor it with Galaxy Dairy Meal Chocolate or Walker's Cheese and Onion Crisps, none of which I've had since the beginning of Lent. Yes, it's Palm Sunday today. Go on. What's Palm Sunday? Heathens, dear. Palm Sunday. Look it up. I'm not going through it now. Very important. Very sad when they read that passage out at church, the gospel at church. Very, very sad today. Duke's with us. Please shout out to my eggs. You what? What do you mean, please shout out to your eggs, Duke? I don't understand what that means. Have you got eggs and you talk to them? Well, I've heard of people talking to plants, but eggs? Are you sure? Very, very strange, dear. Very strange. Matt says, I regularly find myself in the can't be bothered mood. Yeah, I was a bit like that tonight. I was like that tonight, to be honest. I was, but I'm all right now. Kelly Kim went to her lot. Have you got an allotment, Kelly Kim? Oh, I had one of those years ago. Too much hard work. It wasn't actually the digging and the planting. The thing is, you'd have to load up the car with your spade and shovel and all that business, drive to the allotment, unload it, walk the stuff to, and then start work. And I found that too much hard work. I mean, I've done some vegetables in the garden of varying different success stories. Very easy to grow, Kelly Kim, are runner beans. My God, you'd be giving them away. They are so easy to grow, runner beans, and you get so many of them off one plant. Tomatoes, I don't know why, but the tomatoes in my garden kept getting blight. And once they got blight, you got to chuck them away. I had a load of tomatoes 2 years in a row, and I had to chuck away about 95, 98% of them because they got these brown patches all over them. And then I read somewhere that once you've got blight, then you shouldn't grow tomatoes in the same part of your garden for some years. I think it's about 4 or 5 years. So I've given up with those. Runner beans are really easy. But of course, you know, if you want flowers, so I changed and I started growing flowers again, especially when I can just pop down to Waitrose and get a bag of carrots, can't you? I did grow some carrots and they were so long, you know, they were so long, they were all right. The only thing is my garden doesn't get the summer, the sun all day long. I get it about a third of the day. I'm kind of southwest facing, so I only get it about sort of between between 12 and 3 o'clock in the afternoon, which isn't long enough for a lot of things to grow, unfortunately. Hello to the lovely Kareem. Hello, Kareem. All right, sir. Matt says he had a very successful curry and was very impressed with my homemade chapatis. Well, I don't know what they are. I'm not a curry eater, I'm afraid. I don't know what chapati is. That some sort of bread? I'm guessing it's some sort of bread. I don't know. Ashley Smith is with us today. I can only dread to think what Palm Sunday is. I can only imagine. Well, it's nothing to do with palm oil, you heathen. Look it up, dear. Palm Sunday. Very important, dear. Very important. Oh, it's a Lyle and Scott shirt. Thank you. It's a Lyle and Scott shirt. This is quite old. I actually haven't bought any clothes some time now. I nearly bought a lovely grey jacket a couple of days ago, but I couldn't part with the money. Couldn't do it. Couldn't do it. I hummed and hawed and I walked past it several times in Bentles in Bracknell, but I just could not part with the money, so I didn't buy it in the end. And then, of course, and it, for 2 days, it was 20% off. Now it's gone back to the normal price. No chance of me buying it. Absolutely no chance of me buying it. But I am shortly, it's my best mate's birthday soon. And on our birthdays, okay, we have like Chris's day. Right, so he comes round here and for one day we do whatever I want to do. Well, it's his and I had that in February. What did I do anyway? I can't remember now. I think we went shopping somewhere. Did we go shopping? What did I do for Chris's day this year? Don't know. Can't remember. Anyway, for his birthday this year, he wants to go shopping, which we've done a few times now, to Bicester. To Bicester, what's it called now? Outlet. Retail outlets. So you've got all the designer shops there, but you'll find a lot of clothes much cheaper. And it's a whole day out, that is. Oh, it's fantastic. The way it's all laid out, free parking and all that, you know, it's not so unusual to have free parking. You know, the Americans laugh at us, you know, paying for parking. I mean, where else can you go? Is it the same the world over where you want to go to the shop and buy something, so you drive there and have to pay to park your car and then buy something with your money? The Americans don't have any of that. Ah, oh, they laugh at us. It's outrageous, isn't it? So we go to Bicester. We'll be going to Bicester Shopping Village, and I might buy myself a couple of little items there if they're on discount. I rarely buy clothes at the full price. Of course, certainly not the Ted Baker stuff. Anyway, I love Ted Baker stuff. Let's have a look there. Colin's with us this evening. Good evening, Colin. Hope you had a nice time last night at the Georgian Dragon, did you, sir? Hope my good friend Grant DJ's there. I hope he kept you dancing all night, did he? You do that dance, don't you? I remember that dance in the city of Quebec. Fantastic. You were fantastic. I love the gold chain. Your whole character is fantastic. It really is, Colin. Hope you were, sir. Kelly Kim has a shed. Oh, you keep all your stuff in there, do you, Kelly Kim? She's got a shed. Oh, my God. Is that where you put bad people in there? You tie them up. You will be punished by staying in there. Just give them a saucer of water and a few breadcrumbs before as they've been so disobedient, Kelly Kim. Yes. Jason Carter says tomato need lots of water. Yes, indeed they do, Jason. But there's something in the garden that was infecting them. I think that'd be the word. Would it infecting them? So I can't grow those in the garden at the moment. Lee says he's a landscape gardener, and I must admit I was impressed with your garden, Chris. Good job. Oh, do you think so? Now, Lee, my garden is not one of those where everything's cut into a perfect circle and little trees are cut into a perfect triangle and things like that. I like it a bit wild. And I based my garden, actually, where my mate lives, who's about, it's about 20 minutes walk away, 5 minutes in the car. That's where my mate lives. On the corner of, as you go into his little path, this bloke had done this garden, and basically he sees a space and he puts a plant in. And I looked at it and it was kind of wild, but with lots of flowers and things like that. And I thought, do you know, I really like that. So that big space that you saw on this afternoon's mini video, that big space in the middle of the garden was once a shed. A great big shed full of rubbish, just rubbish records, actually. I had a lot of my records stored in there. But do you know what? I never, those records never came out of their boxes. They never did. And one day I kept looking at this shed. How much is that shed? I'd like a bit of garden back, you know. And me and my mate destroyed the shed. And that was hard work because this shed was bespoke. Whoever it was living here before, I think his name was Trevor, if I remember rightly. He built the shed and he was a bit of a handyman. It was all done proper, you know. No nails, all screws. It was insulated. It had that horrible fiberglass. You know, you touch it and it starts getting all really itchy. Oh, it was really well done. And we had a great deal of trouble getting that down. But we did it eventually. And there is actually a video to that. I can look it up if you want. I don't know if I'm going to find it, actually. It'll be amongst the... I don't think it's a direct Facebook update, upload, that one. I think that went on to YouTube. And you can see us taking the shed apart. Actually, though, there is a little bit of it. You know the video that I play at the end of all different things that I've done and what have you? Right at the very end, just before it goes into the United Kingdom Talk logo, there's a bit of me taking that shed down. And health and safety would go bleeding mad. They'd go absolutely off their heads if they saw that. I'll tell you. And there's a bit where we're trying to break the roof of the shed. So I jump on it. Well, it didn't break. I just bounced straight off it again. Nearly killed myself. Honestly, but I did have the sense to wear gloves. If you're doing anything like that, you've got to have a pair of leather gloves on. The last thing you want is some dirty, great big splinter. So I was going to say spider then. It was a blooming spider outside today, big thing, hanging down from my doorway. You don't want a great big splinter in your hand. That will hurt. Jeez, that would hurt. So if you've got time, wait till the very end of the show. Or maybe, if I know a lot of people don't. I know most people don't stay the whole show. They're kind of in and out of it. I know that. But if you come back to it later and then kind of scroll right through to the last 30 seconds of the show, and you'll see that little bit. But I'll try and find that and perhaps repost it on the Facebook wall at some point. Maybe tomorrow, if I can find it, okay? All right. So Lee's a landscape gardener. Have I said that right? Chapatis. Yeah, that's, I reckon, that's an Indian word, isn't it? Chapatis? Yeah, I recognise that word. A thin, unleavened flatbread. Similar to that used making wraps. So thank you very much. Yes, I understand what that is. Gparti is phonetical. Gparti. Now I know the word. Thank you, Kelly Kim. You're wonderful. Do you know you should have been a teacher, Kelly Kim? You'd be good at something like that. Although I don't know if you'd be strict enough. Yeah, I think you'd let the kids get away with murder. Children, I hate that word, kids. I think you'd get the children get away with murder. Talking of children getting away with murder, I'm very, very disappointed with my niece and my niece-in-law today. Because my great-grandnephews, Harry and George, and my great-nieces, Olivia, Evie and Emily, and there's one on the way as well, did an Easter egg hunt today and ended up eating Easter eggs. Not before Easter. Please. It's like that old thing of people giving birthday presents and Christmas presents before Christmas and birthdays. How can you have Easter eggs before Easter? So Easter Day will come. What have they got to look forward to? Oh, well, do we get Easter eggs today? Well, you do. Oh, but we've had those already. You've lost that element of that on the same day, you see. Very, very disappointed. Yes, of course I had a good time. And do I want to see them happy and playing around? Of course I do. But you shouldn't be having Easter eggs before Easter. You've done it as well, haven't you? You've done it as well. The exception, I think the exception to it is cream eggs. Cadbury's cream eggs. You can have those before and after, I think. But big Easter eggs, you shouldn't be having those before Easter. If you are about to give a child one, then take it back immediately. Shocking. Absolutely shocking, that is. There's Shania. Shania will agree with me on that one. I know you. Oh, some people sharing the videos on their wall. Thank you very much. That's much appreciated. It's very kind of you to share videos. I never ask. Because I think that's personally up to you. You know, you see people, especially on Periscope, which I've now deleted. I'm not bothering with Periscope as well. Oh, if you're watching the show, please share and copy it to your wall. And no, don't do that. But, you know, it is appreciated when you do. So thank you very much for that. Shania will agree with me. You shouldn't be having Easter eggs before Easter. It's wrong. Matt says you can't eat them before Easter, as I gave up chocolate for Lent. Me too, Matt. Did I lose any weight? No. Bread, crisps, cakes, chocolate, all that I gave up. Lose weight? Nothing. Not a single pound. I think in the first week it went down a bit, but then it went back up again. What's all that about? Good afternoon to Graham, who says, you certainly have caught the sun today. Oh, it's beautiful out there. I'm very, very brown today. I'm feeling wonderful. I'm firing on all cylinders. Merlin's with us. Don't like Easter eggs. They taste strange. Well, probably so do you, Merlin. I might come and have a little taste of you one day. A little lick of your ear or something like that. Would you like that? Would you like a little taste like that? Matt reckons he's gained weight over Lent. But didn't you just go on holiday, Matt? I think you've just been on holiday, which of course will bring on the weight whenever you go on holiday. Funnily enough, I was just talking to my lovely neighbour, Pearl. And Pearl lives like 1, 2, 3 doors away from me. And she's just been on a cruise and had a wonderful time on that lovely cruise. I went on one years and years ago to Mexico. Actually, I was with my best mate, Ron, and we had this terrible row on the boat. And I ended up coming back a week early. It's not the only time we've rowed on. In fact, it's at the point now where I refuse to go away on holiday with anyone anymore. Because I've been away on holiday with not loads of people. Certainly Ronnie. I had a mate called Steve. Is that the only two? It might be the only two, actually. I've only been on holiday with two people, I think. And they both end up in rows. So I won't go on holiday with anyone more, other than my family. My sister is up north. I've been on holiday with my nephew, Jimmy. I took him to Florida a couple of years ago when he was 17. And I've been away with my other nephew and his little family, caravan. My niece and her little family, caravan. And that all works fantastically. But going on holiday with friends, I think, is a different thing altogether. It really is. Because you want to do different things. And then suddenly, you're stuck with that person that you quite like 24 hours a day. Oh, yes. Can you cope? A lot of couples go on holiday and finish up, break it up after that, you know. They do. Holiday alone, that's my advice to you. Shania says, well, people, Easter eggs from work as we have broken up for the holidays, but I don't eat any until Easter Sunday. That's all right. That's all right. So you've got your Easter eggs, but you can't eat Easter eggs before Easter Sunday. You just can't. Forget the whole, even if you forget the whole religion thing. Okay? Well, actually, Easter eggs are nothing to do with religion anyway. They're just Easter eggs are for Easter Sunday, not Good Friday, not the week before, not the month before. What's all that about, eh? Shania says, we've broken up for the holidays, so she's got her eggs, but I don't eat any until Easter Sunday, more for the fact I've given up chocolate for Lent as well. You as well! We've all given up the chocolate, haven't we, Shania? Marvellous there. Gustav says, you may not have lost weight because on Saturday's show, you mentioned that after Central Station, you stopped off for chips and didn't mention the portion of chips that you had at the beginning of the night at Central Station with half a ton of ketchup. And let's not mention the custard creams. I think that's what's happened, Gustav. I've replaced the chocolate and crisps with other things. Now, I had intended to do this, Gustav. I had intended to replace them with bananas, but it just hasn't worked out. Yes, I do have bananas, but then I find myself having biscuits after that. It's so difficult. Look at you, thin as a rake. How do you do that, Gustav? Thin as a rake. Matt says, my holiday was a weekend in Berlin. That was about a month ago. Was it that long ago now? I've never been to Germany. Not been to Germany yet for a wedding. Jason is off on a cruise on Friday. Miami, here I come. Now, is that from the UK? Or do you fly... Oh, what have I done there? Oh, just a minute. Oh, dear. Don't say I'm going to lose those... is that right? There we are. Okay. Yeah, Jason's off on a cruise on Friday. So, Miami, are you going from the UK or are you flying to America? Which way are you doing it? Be interested to know that. And talking of holidays, here we go. Now, this has come in from Wendy, who sent this in today. These are the real complaints received by Thomas Cook Holiday from dissatisfied customers. Because there's always someone moaning, isn't there? There's always someone moaning about their holidays. Have you noticed that? Oh, the bed was a bit uncomfortable. I've got to say, I'm a bit funny with beds as well. I have a great deal of difficulty sleeping anywhere other than my own bed. Although last night, I had trouble sleeping last night for some reason as well. What about you? Do you sleep all right abroad? Do you take your own sheets? I'm frightened of bed bugs. What if you bring them home? And you wouldn't know, would you? That's the thing. They hide. Bed bugs are hiding. Yes. I mean, it's all very well taking your own sheets, but if you take your own sheets on holiday, then when you finish, you must put them in a plastic bag and seal it with sellotape. And then bring them home, shove them straight in the washing machine on maximum 90 degrees boil wash to kill those evil critters. My mate had bed bug once. Oh, it was awful. Oh, my word. Not my best mate. This is Grant, actually, who's a DJ. He had bed bugs once and he was little bites all over him. Because you don't see them. They come out at night when you're asleep. It's all very spooky. Yes, bed bugs at night. Don't if you're telling children's stories just before they go off to sleep, although they should all be asleep now at 10:15 at night, dear. Who's keeping those children up so blooming late tonight? Get them in bed. Get them in bed immediately. But if you do children's stories, do not include bed bugs in any of the stories. They never get to sleep, you know. They never get to sleep. So here we go, boys and girls. Thomas Cook. Thomas Cook complaints from dissatisfied customers. Coming up for you right now. Here we go. Number one. On my holiday to Goa in India, I was disgusted to find that almost every restaurant served curry. I don't like spicy food. Why are you going to India then, you stupid person? You have to go there and eat what they eat, don't you? This is another reason I don't like going away too much. I'm all right in America, Australia, somewhere like that. India? Oh, I'd never be able to eat. Although I did have a beef curry once years ago when I was eating dead animals. I don't eat dead animals anymore. But I had this beef curry cooked for me by a person who worked in the Golden Lion in King's Cross. The pub's no longer there. And I really enjoyed it. One day he put too much of something in it. Me and my mate John, we were sweating like anything. Oh, talking of sweating, you see that bit there? Right, that bit there. Yeah, that bit there. I've noticed now, if I have a spicy food, for example, Five Guys Cajun chips. If I sit there and eat Five Guys Cajun chips, then the top of my head starts sweating profusely. Does that happen to any of you baldies out there? I bet it does, doesn't it? Or today I had, just before I came up to chat to you, I had spaghetti arrabbiata or whatever it's called. That again made the head, and you can feel it start sweating. While you're eating it, not by touching it, you just know. And you go like that and it's all sticky. Here's another one. They should not allow topless sunbathing on the beach. It's very distracting for my husband who just wanted to relax. Have you ever complained to a holiday people that you've been on holiday with? Have a little think about that. I'd love you to call in. If you've ever had to complain about a holiday, I'd love you to call in. The phone number, 0208 144 3477. I'll stick it back up on the screen in a minute, okay? We went on holiday to Spain and had a problem with the taxi drivers as they were all Spanish. These are real complaints that have come into Thomas Cook over the years. We booked an excursion to a water park, but no one told us we had to bring our own swimsuits and towels. We assumed they'd be included in the price. Oh, really? You'd wear someone else's swimming costume? Oh, no, not unless you see a picture of the person before, because they might be quite nice. You know, If I was going on an excursion like that, and I, you know, they provided swimming costumes, I'd want to know who wore them first. And if a picture of Cristiano Ronaldo came on, I'd have those shorts on straight away, and they wouldn't get them back either. The beach was too sandy. We had to clean everything when we returned to our room. Exactly. Don't go on a sandy beach. Horrible places, sandy beaches. We found the sand was not like the sand in the brochure. Your brochure shows the sand as white, but it was more yellow. Can you believe these complaints? It's lazy of the local shopkeepers in Puerto Vallatato to close in the afternoons. I often needed to buy things during siesta time. This should be banned. No one told us there would be fish in the water. The children were scared. Oh, those poor little children. Although the brochures said there was a fully equipped kitchen, there was no egg slicer in the drawers. Stupid, stupid people. I think it should be explained in the brochure that the local convenience store does not sell proper biscuits like custard creams or ginger nuts. Well, take your own, you stupid people. See, these sort of people, they should be going on caravan holidays like me. You go shopping if you want before you even go on holiday. And you've got your bags full of all the stuff you want. I've got my Waitrose spaghetti arrabbiata. I've got my wholemeal spaghetti. I've got my corn steaks. They're all in the bag and I just take them up there in the caravan and I can have exactly what I have down here. No complaints about the food. Don't need to complain. Got it all with me. Here's another one. The roads were uneven and bumpy, so we could not read the local guidebook during the bus ride to the resort. Because of this, we were unaware of many things that would have made our holiday more fun, you thick people. It took us It took us 9 hours to fly home from Jamaica to England. It took the Americans only 3 hours to get home. This seems unfair. You do wonder what sort of schools these idiots went to, don't you? I compared the size of our one-bedroom suite to our friend's three-bedroom, and ours was significantly smaller. Don't you want to meet these thickos? They really are thick. The brochure stated no hairdressers at the resort. We're trainee hairdressers, and we think they knew that and made us wait longer for the service. When we were in Spain, there were too many Spanish people there. The receptionist spoke Spanish. The food was Spanish. No one told us there would be so many foreigners. Are you serious? These are real complaints that Thomas Cook has received. We had to line up outside to catch the boat as there was no air conditioning. It is your duty as a tour operator to advise us of noisy or unruly guests before we travel. And that's another problem, isn't it, going on holiday? What if you're sitting in the plane behind the family from hell? Shut up! Oh, disgusting people. You don't get that in business class, you know. You've got to save up for the posh seats. I say that, you can do. I found the people in business class can be bloody rude to the members of staff when I've flown British Airways a few years ago now. Some of those people with the money are bloody rude and there's no need to talk to anyone like a piece of dirt. It really isn't. I was really nice to them. I got a bottle of champagne because they said I was nice. Thank you. Nice, is it? Nice, nice. I was bitten by a mosquito. The brochure did not mention mosquitoes. And finally, my fiancé and I requested twin beds when we booked, but instead we were placed in a room with a king-size bed. We now hold you responsible and want to be reimbursed for the fact that I became pregnant. This would not have happened if you put us in the room that we had booked. Stupid, 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 stupid thick people. I can't believe it. How stupid they can be. Anyway, there's... there's some of the holiday stories. I don't know if you've got a holiday story or two that you might want to tell us about on the show tonight, boys and girls. It's 020-8144-3477, my phone number, okay? 020-8144-3477. Tell me about your holiday woes. Something you perhaps didn't quite expect on holiday. My holiday woes are the fact that I just row all the time. Just end up being very, very disappointed, so I don't go with anyone anymore. Unless they're family, of course. What about you? Maybe you've been away with someone. Was that a disaster? Was it someone you really, really like, this person, and then you go on holiday and it just doesn't work? And actually, you can't put your finger on it. It's probably neither of your fault. You know, it's just a bit of a mismatch. You can't blame one or the other. I certainly don't blame my mate. I don't think he blames me, you know. But I know, whereas he would try again, I won't do it again. Never say never. As Sean Connery said, and he was back doing the Bond. Are you enjoying the show tonight? It's so much better than sitting in a hot, sweaty club, listening to loud music. Bang, bang. Oh, if you want to be my lover. And the Spice Girls. Isn't this so much better? Just a nice relaxing night of a few friends talking together. Oh, yes. Kevin says, I've never, ever been away. Is that right, Kevin? Why not? Why have you never been away? You don't have to go on a plane. You can just book out a caravan or maybe a chalet somewhere, Pontins or something like that, or just a hotel, a room in a hotel, cheap hotel. You have to have a little holiday, Kevin. Go somewhere, dear. Go somewhere. Lee, you noticed that mistake. Yes. Tanya, stop it, everyone. Stop it, Carl. Stop it. James says, I hear they just turn the sheets inside out rather than washing them at some hotels. Well, that wouldn't surprise me. Oh, that's disgusting, isn't it? That is disgusting. It wouldn't surprise me at all. Take your own sheets in. That's what I say. Jason said, I was going from Miami to Southampton. So do you fly to Miami and then come back to Southampton on the boat? I see. Now, I really hate flying. I keep saying this. I hate flying. I think I'd quite like to go on a holiday. I think I'd probably do a cruise from Southampton. So you just drive. I've never done this, but you drive to Southampton, you get out of the car and onto the boat and you're there. That's it. None of this mucking about at hotels, having to wait and queue up. I mean, presumably you have to do some sort of security check and passports and all that business before you go on the boat, I suppose. So there must be something like that. But I gather it's nowhere near as bad as it is when you're flying from place to place or something like that, you know. Okay. Now, there's a little petition here that you might want to sign, boys and girls. A little petition here. Here it is. Good. Stop supermarkets from selling raw fruit and veg in plastic packaging. Now, I don't know if you've noticed this over the years, but your bin fills up quicker and quicker. Have you noticed that? And all this business with a recycling bin and all that. I remember when I was a child, we lived in Roehampton, and the whole block, great big block, and there was one of those paladins. You know, the great big bins, and you take your rubbish along to the chute and you'd throw it out. But they'd only empty this paladin twice a week. Now, they have to do it every other day. And all this stuff comes from plastic packaging. We never had plastic packaging years ago. If you wanted to buy a pound of potatoes, you bought a pound and they put it in a little paper bag or just shoved it in your carrier bag. That's how it worked. Same with apples, bananas, everything like that. But now you go to the supermarket and there it is. All little polystyrene tray and a bit of plastic there and a label. Three items of packaging. The polystyrene tray, the plastic and the label. I mean, how much more packaging can you have? Well, someone's got this. It's on one of those change.org things, which is like a petition site. And you could have your own petition on there if you wanted to. For example, you could have a petition saying all members of the world should be informed about United Kingdom Talk, this programme hosted by yours truly. You know, you could have that petition. Please sign this. And if so many people sign it, then I think it goes to government or something like that. I think it's 100,000 people, and then you can sign. It goes to government. They chat about it then or something like that. Anyway, so here's one. In all supermarkets in the UK and some independent greengrocers as well, we often see fruit and vegetables sold packaged in plastic bags. And to be fair, that's quite right. You know, it's not just supermarkets. You go in the small corner shops and there it is. One apple in a little plastic fit, in a plastic polystyrene tray with plastic over the top of it and another label on top of that. The same retailers will sell the particular fruit or vegetable both in pre-packed and loose form, which leads one to believe that the pre-packed version is simply offered convenience or to maximise profits. And you often do find, actually, that bag of carrots that costs, I don't know, a pound. If you weigh those carrots out yourself, probably be 65 pence. Never go for the pre-packaged ones. It's always cheaper to buy loose, especially in Aldi. Aldi are dirt cheap for their fruit and veg. But I will say I've bought stuff from there before. It doesn't seem to last very long. Now, I was talking to a Waitrose delivery driver about that. And I said I had been buying some fruit and veg in Aldi and it's dirt cheap. It's like 49 pence or something ridiculous like that. Whereas in Waitrose, you might be paying £1 for the same thing. And the delivery driver told me it's because they don't keep everything cool. So if it's coming from Waitrose, I gather, you know, the apples get picked and they go in a cool store. From there, they get taken in a cool lorry to the distribution place where they're kept in a cool environment. Then they go in their cool lorries out to the various shops and are placed in a cool position in the shop. In Aldi, I don't think, I mean, don't quote me on that, but that the Waitrose driver told me they don't do any of that cooling down. Or if they do, it's not done at every step of the way. And that's why it doesn't last as long. There's nothing wrong with it if you buy it and eat it quickly. But I've bought stuff in there and very quickly it's gone green and not nice. I chuck it over the fence then. Well, it disintegrates. It's normal, isn't it? Sucking it over the fence. Can I turn my air conditioning on just a minute? It's very hot in here tonight. Is that going to come on? There we are. I haven't had that on for months, that thing. I ought to turn that on now and again to keep it going. I hope there's not any listeria. Is it listeria? No, Legionnaire's disease, you get an air conditioning, don't you? Is that if it goes down quite cold? Air conditioning, I don't know. The story goes on. When one considers the huge amount of plastic that's used for making packaging, it would be hard to believe that the damage to the environment would be the same or even more than that of which plastic carriers cause. There is no reason why fruit and vegetables, with very rare exceptions, can't be sold in their natural form by weight. And it makes sense, doesn't it? Furthermore, the supermarkets can replace the small, clear plastic bags that they place on the fruit and vegetable aisles with brown paper bags, which would be much better. And also, I think, you know, sometimes you put stuff in a little plastic bag and it sweats, doesn't it? It starts sweating. Not very nice, dear. Not very nice. Furthermore, the supermarket can replace the small plastic bags with paper ones, same as those they offer for buying mushrooms. Well, they got it for mushrooms. Why not for everything else? I don't understand. Is it cheaper for them to provide plastic bags, perhaps? Soft fruits such as strawberries, raspberries, blackberries, grapes and blueberries can also be sold in rugged. Oh, it's like me, isn't it? Rugged. Do I look rugged? Do I look like a rugged person to you? I've got the shape, haven't I? Don't you think? I've got the shoulders. You think I'm a bit rugged? Rugged? Huh? Cardboard punnets are made of recycled paper and cardboard and can be recycled again and are biodegradable. So that goes on. So there is a little petition to sign there on change.org. And the title of the post is Stop Supermarkets from Selling Raw Fruit and Veg in Plastic Packaging. OK, very, very important. Of course, from the supermarket's point of view, it has to be said that if everyone stopped buying stuff pre-packaged and you all started buying the loose stuff, then they wouldn't be selling it. It's only because you have the power to change stuff. You really do. It's all very well complaining about, I don't know, people say McDonald's is bad for you, don't they? They say having McDonald's is bad for you all the time. I've got to be, I don't eat McDonald's very rarely. Only the milkshakes and the apple pies and the chips. That's about all I have from there. And it's quite rare that I go into McDonald's. But I would never slag it off. I think they're some of the cleanest restaurants you've ever seen. They always seem to be cleaning in there, don't they? And they're busy. They're busy. That's what people want. I don't see how people can run something down if they're going in there all the time. Let's just go back there. 1 second now. Adam's just joining us. Good evening to Adam. Adam the plumber. How are you getting on with your website? Anything happening there? Adam's trying to make a website, but he's not sure he's doing it right. And he might need some help. If anyone could help him, you'll see him up on there. Adam Tubero. It's Adam the plumber, okay? So if you can help in any way at all. Now, I don't think that's chucking out any cold air today. Hang on a minute. I've got the wrong setting on here. Maybe it needs to. I don't know what's going on here. I haven't had this on for months and months and months. That's probably why it's not working. Give it a little while, and I should be getting blasts of cold air at some point. Matt says, I hate how much they rely on prepackaged fruit and veg, as it puts me off buying it, as they're always in quantities that I'm never going to get through. I would prefer to have it loose. Well, yeah, that's the thing. And that's like those two-for-one businesses, you know. How many times have you bought a two-for-one and had to chuck the other one away? Just a complete waste of money, isn't it? James says, speaking of petitions, what do you think about the petition trying to ban Donald Trump for visiting the UK? I don't know, really. I mean, he's a world leader. Whether you like him or not, I think you've got to let him come. I do. If he's a world leader, you know, it's like, let me think. I'm not keen on Jeremy Corbyn. Okay? But I would talk to him, you know, as another human. Really? So, yeah. So I'm along those lines. I think you need to let him come. Because he's a world leader. It's not like, let's think. Anyone that we don't like that isn't a world leader, I don't know. Russell Brand, I wouldn't want to talk to him. I just think he's such an arsehole, I really do. Alan says, I prefer loose fruit and veg, but Aldi's are a bit dirty. I don't know, Alan, I don't go along now. I wouldn't say Aldi is dirty. But it just doesn't seem to last very long. In my experience, their fruit and veg just doesn't seem to last long. If you buy it and use it within 2 days, I'm sure it's fine. Anything longer than that, you know, it starts going a bit funny. Graham says, try lifting the sheets on holiday and looking at the stains on the mattress. Take a bug spray and spray the bed. I think that's excellent advice, Graham. I really do. That is excellent advice. Take a bug spray. Can you get bed bug spray? Huh? The trouble is then, of course, you're lying on loads of chemicals, aren't you? So you can't win. Do you want to be bitten? Or do you want to burn to death on evil chemicals? Oh, did you see that story in Islington? Was it last night or yesterday daytime? Some idiot threw acid over someone? Dreadful people. Just dreadful people. What was all that about? We don't know the whole story of that yet, do we? Matt says, a bit of dirt doesn't hurt, Alan. Just stick the fruit and veg under the tap and wash. Yeah, totally. I mean, if you were growing your own stuff, you'd have to do that anyway. I did try potatoes once. The only thing is with potatoes, so I did them for, and it was reasonably successful. Got loads of little potatoes out of there. That worked. It's quite nice digging up your own potatoes. But then I converted that area to flowers, as I said earlier on in the show. And now and again, I still get potatoes coming up. Where's that come from? Because they leave some under the ground. And if you haven't got them all up, they come back up again as more potatoes. Matt worked at Asda and has very little choice in the loose range. Well, Asda, I haven't been in an Asda for some time now. We have got one round here, and the petrol's dirt cheap in Asda. The cheapest petrol is always in Asda, but it's a little bit far away from me. It's not really worth me going unless I go to, there's a showcase cinema in Winnersh, which I don't think is too far away from you, actually, Matt. Showcase cinema in Winnersh. If you ever want to go to the cinema, go to that one because they've got the seats and they go all the way down. All not the premium ones, all of them. All of them have got buttons. And you like that, and it's very comfortable. And your legs come up. Just like Tower Bridge, it is. Just like Tower Bridge. Sorry, Woking Asda. I beg your pardon. Woking Asda has very little choice in the loose range. There's a Waitrose at Asda as well. Have you found that yet? Try it in there, lovey. Graham says, how comes they charge 5p for a carrier bag, but there is more plastic all over the products that you buy? That's free. Yeah, you're right. I do occasionally tend to press no bag on self-service tills and still take a bag. Oh, my God. Oh, hang on a minute. My mate's calling in here. Just a second now. Hello.
Hello.
I have to tell you, we are live on air at the moment, my dear. Would you like to say hello to the viewers?
Hello, viewers.
Just a moment. Say hello to them. It's best mate Ron with his new glasses on. All right. Hello to you. I'll be on. What time are you coming home from your friend's house?
About 1:15.
1:15. I might still be up then.
I'll give you a try.
Okay, cheerio. Bye bye. Are you not screening the show in there, dear? Yes. I'm sure you can screen. Put me on a little screen there. Thank you. Bye bye. Yeah. Fabbing it, eh? Oh, calls coming in left, right and centre here, boys and girls. Good evening to Rachel Davis. Matt, can I just tell you, Rachel's in Woking as well. I don't know if you know that. Rachel's in Woking. Matt is now in Woking. He's been living there for about 6 weeks or so now. So say hello to each other. You become new best friends. Oh, yes. Oh, yes, indeed. Yes. So Graham says, I do occasionally tend to press no bag on self-service and still take a bag. Please don't tell the bag, please. That is disgusting. Well, that's theft, that is, Graham. And without saying too much, I'm very surprised at you and in the position that you're in, dear. Stealing from supermarkets. Yes, it is the same as stealing a packet of biscuits, dear. Thief! Thief! You should have gone to church on Palm Sunday. You should have gone. Yes. Thank you very much. Rachel says, Matt, move while you can. It's a dump. Woking is very, very expensive to live there, isn't it? Yeah. So that's the petition. Remember that. Change.org. Stop supermarkets from selling raw fruit and veg in plastic packaging. I think that's a very, very sensible thing. Very, very sensible indeed. Now, I came across something today. Actually, I came across this. Just ghastly game. It's a ghastly, ghastly game on Amazon. While I was getting ready to do the show today, and I've got the music playing in the back, because I hear the music. I don't hear the music right to the end. If I do, then you would hear like an echo. We can't have echoing, dear. There's no echoing going on in this studio. And I was looking around, and on Facebook, an advert for Amazon, a game came up. Check this out. If you are a cat lover, you will think this is awful. New game on Amazon Launchpad, which it says it's a unique products from startups. The game is called Exploding Kittens. A card game about kittens and explosions and sometimes goats. And the summary says, Exploding Kittens is a card game for people who are into kittens and explosions and laser beams and sometimes goats. Family-friendly party game for 2 to 5 players, up to 9 players when combined with any other deck. This is the most backed project in Kickstarter history, and all cards feature illustrations by the Oatmeal. What the hell is the Oatmeal? Anyone know? What's that? Includes 56 cards. The box, like 99.99%, does not meow. See more product details. Right, okay. Right. So how much is this game? Oh, it's 15 quid. Oh, I don't think I can stretch to £15. Oh, God, no, Jimmy. £15. Exploding kittens. A game about kittens and explosions. Let's have a look at the customers' reviews. Customers' reviews. We'll just go to the top ones. It says here, brilliant game. Doesn't bring the hilarity value that Cards Against Humanity brings. But what it does do is bring a huge amount of tension and wry smiles to the tables. Sometimes you can't avoid making it obvious that you're setting someone up to explode. What a cat! How awful. Someone else here. Bought this as a Christmas gift and my family and myself ended up playing it into the wee small hours of Boxing Day morning. The game is a lot of fun, addictive and can be very funny as well. We had 5 players in each game and everyone really enjoyed playing it. It is easy enough to learn and has elements of Russian roulette. Now what's that Russian roulette? I know that game. Russian roulette. Fun and simple. A fun, simple game. With, of course, hilarious artwork by Oatmeal. Is that name again? Oatmeal. I would rate it as 3.5 out of 5. So there we are. So that might be a little game that you might want to order off Amazon. As I say, it's a launch pad. It's a new product. And it's called Exploding Kittens. Available from Amazon. One-click ordering. Reduced price from £20 to £15. Gling! Money in the bank, boys and girls. Amazon, dear, dear me. Elaine says, I'm very curious. You said earlier that you hate sandy beaches. So how did you manage in Israel that has most sandy beaches? Elaine, I was very near to the hotel, actually. I stayed at the... Oh, gosh, what's it called? What was the hotel? It's a posh hotel in London, but it's nowhere near the same as that. It's like a boutique hotel. Was it the Hilton? I don't know. Hang on, let me see if I can find it. Not Ritz, not Hilton. Hotel Tel Aviv. Tel Aviv, Israel. You ever want a damn good holiday, go to Tel Aviv. It's a fantastic place, Tel Aviv. Let's have a look. Boutique hotels. The 10 best boutique hotels. Let me see. Crown Plaza. No, that's not it. No. Shalom. No. Oh, I'm not going to find that now, am I? I can't remember what it was called now. I'm sorry. I remember. So the hotel was invaded in the 70s. Does that help? Let me see. Hotel... Invaded Tel Aviv. See if that brings anything up. Savoy. That was it, the Savoy. I stayed at the Savoy. That's right, Elaine. It was the Savoy. I stayed there. Lovely little place it was. Really, I tell you what, that camera don't like that shirt, does it? Look at that. Can you see how it keeps jumping now and again? It doesn't like the shirt. That's what that is. Yes, it was the Savoy. Lovely little place. And it was so close to the beach that really the sand didn't bother me. Although I don't think I went on the beach, actually. Elaine, I was out every day on a trip. Every single day doing a church or the Dead Sea or that mountain, Sinai Mountain or something like that, where I think Herod had a castle or something like that, wasn't it? I did a trip every day, Elaine. It was fantastic. Russian roulette is the game, thank you, Matt, with a gun that is loaded one chamber and take it in turns. The loser ends up dead as they have blown their brains out. I think I played a similar game like that, Matt, in Chariots. And I lost. I'm sure I played a similar game to that in Chariots and I lost, Matt. Yes. Perhaps you've played the similar game as well. Alan says, I like Woking, nice place. They don't have people like you in Woking, do you? You wouldn't get in there. They'd stop you before you got there. Don't think you can just walking through Woking Town Centre, dear. They have one of those ghastly toy shops. Toys R Us. Oh, they're horrendous, they are. Toys R Us. No atmosphere whatsoever. A little bit like watching some of the shows I have to work with. The Savoy, that was one. Talking to shows I work with, last night was quite nice, boys and girls. I was working in Central Station. I do most Saturdays at Central Station. Am I there next week? What's the date today? What is it again? The 9th? So, yeah, I'm there next Saturday as well. I don't know what the cabaret is there next Saturday, but I'll be working there next Saturday. And then, so last night I was working there. Good journey in and out last night. That wasn't bad at all. And we had a cabaret, Crystal Ball. That was the drag act last night. She was excellent, actually. Never worked with her before. Very nice to work with. Very professional. Old school. Old school, you know, old school. So very good Crystal Ball last night. Got back here around about 1:30 in the morning, actually. And I did have a cup of tea and some biscuits before I went to bed. I've got two left. Now, when did I buy these? I think it was yesterday morning. Was it Sunday? Was it Sunday? No, Saturday morning I think I bought these. There's two left. That's my tea before I go to bed tonight. I'll probably be going to bed early tonight, I would have thought. Because I've got stuff to do tomorrow. I'll tell you about it tomorrow. So I had trouble sleeping last night, again, on a Saturday night. I don't know why. It's every Saturday. A lot of Saturday nights, for some reason, I have trouble getting to bed, getting to sleep. Anyway, so I'm kind of tossing and turning. Before I knew what it was like 7:20 in the morning. The telly went off. I must have dozed off at some point, I suppose. So I got up about 20 past 7 this morning. And went to church. As I say, it's quite an important day in the Catholic Church. It's Palm Sunday today. I won't go into it for you, but it's very, very important leading up, because it's Holy Week now. So we have Palm Sunday today, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. Then we have Maundy, Thursday, Good Friday, when Jesus is supposed to have died on the cross. Then there's Saturday, and then Easter Sunday, when he rises from the dead, all that business, all right? So I went to Palm Sunday today. Then I got back here, cycled. I cycled to and from Wokingham. It's about 25 minutes there and back again. 25 minutes there, church, 25 minutes back. And it was a lovely morning. And of course, you know, I get on the bike around about 20 past 8 in the morning, and there's no one around. There's no one around on a Sunday, and I literally cycle through fields. And funnily enough, I thought to myself on the way there today, I thought, you know, I should stop. Maybe I'll remember next time I go, guys. I'm not there this Sunday. I'm away this Sunday. I'll get my camera and I'll show you the route, or at least part of it. I'll stop now and again and show you the route. I literally cycle on this road between two fields, and it's just beautiful. I go over a little level crossing, past some really charming cottages in Wokingham along the Waterloo Road, and then kind of up and round, and there's the church there. So I got back here and I went in the garden and read my book. And I thought, shall I do a show? And I thought, there's going to be no one in sitting there who's going to sit in front of a computer and watch a show. I suppose some of you, I don't know how many of you are now watching on a phone? Are you watching on an iPhone in bed or anything like that, or one of those other phones? What is it now? A Windows phone or an Android phone? Is anyone watching on a phone? And I thought, no one's going to want to watch that today. And I thought, well, I'll just sit in the sun and read my book. And I made a very short video of the garden while I was there, telling you I'd be here tonight. The book I'm reading now is about this bloke, and now he's got a brain tumour. And it's gradually eating away at his brain. I've only got sort of to page 10. But I think I might have got into reading. I might have got into reading. And it's all down to that last book, that book I read a while ago called Radio Boy, which I've finished now. Does anyone want that book? Would anyone be interested in reading a book? Radio Boy? It's about this boy, and he sets up a radio station in a shed. That's basically it. And it is hilarious, absolutely hilarious. So if anyone wants it, I'd be happy to give that away to someone. Perhaps you pop into a pub or something like that that I work in. So I read my book, then I did my lunch. I had a Marks and Spencer's mushroom and onion pie, which was quite nice. Then I did some gardening, and my friend Pearl came out. Pearl, now she lives down the end. Me and my mate have now got names for my neighbours. So next door to me is Doorbell Dave, because he's the first one out of all of us who got one of the video doorbells. And I've shown you that so many times now. So someone pushes my doorbell, and the face it comes up on my mobile phone wherever I am in the world, and I can talk to them at my front door. How fantastic is that? It's called Ring. R-I-N, Ring Door, Ring Video Doorbell, if you want to look it up. So that's Doorbell Dave. Did I say Doorbell Dave? Doorbell Dave? I think I said Doorbell Dave. Next to him is Television Tim, because Tim has been on the television. He's a police traffic person on the M25. He goes around the M25. If you break down, his little car comes up. His big car comes along, sits behind you and puts its lights on and tries to assist you. So that's what Television Tim does that. Television Tim is because he's been filmed doing that, you know, for one of those police camera things on the telly. So he's been on there a few times, Television Tim. And at the end, the end is the best one. Now, at the end lives Pearl. Pearl and her husband. And we've named Pearl's in her 60s, and we've named Pearl Babe Station Pearl. And she's just lovely. She's lovely. She says, in my younger days, she used to watch me coming back from this nightclub called Trade at like 2 in the afternoon. You know, usually with someone. In my younger, luckier days. So lucky, very lucky then, very lucky. She used to watch me. She only told me this a few months ago. She said she had some quite nice looking ones walking past my front door. The old net curtains were twitching, were they, Phil? So I was just chatting to Pearl. People keep dumping rubbish around the back of her house, which is not nice, is it? Why do people do that? Why can't they just take it down or put it in their bins? There's one bloke who lives actually very close to me, and he does his hoovering and then empties the hoover in the green bit. Well, why? Why don't you just put it in your bloody bin? I don't understand that at all. Do you? There's laziness half the time with the big items. Well, someone now has dumped an old trampoline behind her house. Oh, it's disgusting. So I had a little chat with Pearl. I love Pearl very much. And then I needed some milk. I realised I'd nearly run out of soya milk, so I needed to go up to Sainsburys. One of my most unpopular supermarkets. So I put my bag together and I thought, do you know what? I'll have a swim. I'll have a swim while I'm up there. So I walked up to the swimming pool. There was no one in there. Oh, it's beautiful walking through. Beautiful walking up to the swimming pool today. Really, really nice. And I walk through a place called South Hill Park. Now, you may have seen this occasionally. I've uploaded pictures from South Hill Park. And it's basically this great big like mansion with a park and a fountain there, and there's all families out there and children running around and people playing football. It's beautiful. And so I walked through there up to the swimming pool, got in the swimming pool, there's no one in there. Lovely, thank you very much. Because I was feeling a bit sticky as well. I'd been reading my book in the sunset. I'd also done some gardening. There's a lot of weeding to be done, so I'm scraping away at those weeds. There's a particularly smelly weed. Don't know if there's any gardeners out there. It looks, the leaves look a little bit like a geranium. And it kind of, lots of stems come out from that. And it's very, very shallow in the ground. So you just got to kick it and it kind of comes out. Oh, it stinks when you move that one. I don't know what it's called. Nasty smelly weed. So I pulled all, spent about an hour doing weeding today. Of course, the garden is very, very dry at the moment. I went swimming. From swimming, I went over to Sainsburys. I bought some milk in there. And a toothbrush. Now, look at these. I had to buy another 4 of these. Now, I was stupid with this because I'd already ordered these from Amazon, but they hadn't come. 4 of these in Sainsburys. How much? 18 quid. I mean, Christ, do me a favour. 18 quid for 4 blooming toothbrushes. Outrageous, isn't it? 18 quid for those. And I just ordered some from Amazon. £11 for 8. There's only 4 in here. But I didn't have them. Of course. So I've bought these. The Amazon. I bet the Amazon ones will arrive tomorrow, won't they? You watch. Anyway, my toothbrush head, it's all flat. So I need to replace that on my electric toothbrush, floss action. So I got those. So I came out of there and it was about 10 to 4 now. Now, as far as I think supermarkets close at 4 o'clock. And blow me down, the amount of people that were coming into that cars queuing up at like 10 to 4. And I'm thinking, do you have any respect for the staff that are here? Presumably, once you're in there, you can take your time. You know, if it says they're closing at 4 o'clock, you know, it doesn't get to 4 o'clock. Right, everybody out, it doesn't work like that. They've got to wait until people are shopping. And you know what people are like. People are horrible. They don't give a toss about anyone, do they? Now, I have a similar problem, actually. In one of the places that I work, there is a group of people that work for the Guardian newspaper, and they sit in the way. They know what time I get there, and they sit. Oh, we won't be long. No, move now, please. I'm trying to set up. Guardian newspaper they are from. Is anyone reading that now? Well, I think they're in their own little world they are. They sit up there and they won't get out of the way until they are ready. Rude. Rude. I couldn't believe the amount of people coming into Sainsburys at 10 to 4. Queues of cars. They know it closes at 4. Oh, we're just getting there. I bet they walk around and they spend ages doing that. I bet they do. Dreadful, dreadful. Oh, we've got some comments coming here. Let's just go back to some of these comments before I go back to my story. Do, 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 do. Oh, there's a lot there. There we are. Do you go to the same church every Sunday? Generally, yes, Alan. Corpus Christi in Wokingham is where I go. On occasions, if I don't wake up, if I decide not to set the alarm and I don't wake up, I can go to two. Well, I can go to three others. There's one at Bracknell, but I don't go there anymore. Half past. There was a particular part of the mass that they used to sing, and it was just so dreary. It was depressing. This song, this particular. It was one of the Gloria. I don't know if you know the Gloria. Gloria, Gloria, Gloria. That one. And it was so depressing. I stopped going. And I told him, I said, can't you find another tune to this? Oh, well, we're looking for another one, he says. This is the organist. Oh, well, we're trying to find another one. And are you serious? There's hundreds of them. And it's so depressing. I'm telling you now, I never went to a funeral and was as depressed as every time I heard that blooming tune. It was the music. It wasn't the words. It was the music. Because the words are set and people have different tunes going to it or arrangements. So I stopped going there. Which is a shame because I like the priest, Father Danny, who is a hoot. He's a hoot, he is. He's hilarious. So I go to Corpus Christi in Wokingham. But there's two others. I can go to Sacred Heart in Sunningdale. Or I can go to St. Francis in Ascot. Which is... Oh, there's some money there, dear. Oh, God. You want to see the cars in the car park there on a Sunday? BMWs and Audis. Great big things. As me with my little RAV4 Toyota. I was embarrassed to get out of the thing. But you know, it doesn't matter where you go, Alan. Always you sit there and people just start talking to you in a church. Wonderful, wonderful, really. Matt is indeed watching on his iPhone. Oh, you'll get have you got glasses on, dear? You'll get bad eyes watching on that tiny screen. Elaine's in bed. You haven't gone to sleep yet, Elaine. Are you watching this to help people go to sleep? People watch this show when they can't sleep, you know. Apparently it sends them off. I don't know what they mean by that, Elaine. Rude, that's what it is. Adam says, I have you on in, I'm on an iPhone. Adam's watching on an iPhone. Ray Reynolds says, don't forget to switch off your set. And from all of us at Thames, especially good night. We're not going yet, Ray. You might go, but we're not going yet. Callum, James Clark says, the Guardian, bloody liberal snowflakes. Absolutely, James. Absolutely. Dreadful paper. Dreadful. And dreadful people that write for it as well. They're rude. They know damn well what time I've got to set up. Why don't they just get out of the way? It's not hard, is it? I would get out. If someone was, you know, I was sitting there. It's 8 o'clock. Oh, the karaoke guy starts now. And I would get out of the way. Absolutely. Straight away. No, no. Oh, we won't be long. And then they just sit there chatting, you know, like nothing's happening around them. Forget the fact that there's people gathering now in front, waiting to sing their songs. I must start on time. I must, and that's ingrained in me, you see. That's from my old British Telecom days. I'm so strict on time. Appointments, I'll be there probably a half an hour before the appointment. That's true. And I must start on time, not for me, but for the people waiting. You know? Callum says selfish, isn't it? Yeah, I think it is, Callum. Hello, Callum. All right. Alan says, Asda here shuts at 6 o'clock on a Sunday. Really? I thought all supermarkets had to close. Ah, do they? Maybe they open later. Don't? Are they? I think they're allowed to trade for 6 hours, which generally is 10 to 4. So maybe they open at 12. Do they, Alan? Perhaps you can look that up for me. Do they open at 12 there, Alan? I'd be interested to see that. James says, bet the Guardian workers are Corbyn supporters. Oh, well, they all are, aren't they? They all are, James. I mean, it's okay if you want to support Corbyn. That's fine, you know. I'm not one of those people that jump down their throats, you know. If you don't agree with me, then you are evil and you must die. There's a lot of people like that now. There's an awful, aren't there? They won't accept anyone else's opinion for anything. You must agree with me or you are evil and you must die. What the hell's... How did we get to all that? I don't know. I was somewhere the other night. Where was I the other day? Oh, God, I can't think. I think it was... Don't know now, but they supported an opposite party to me. And that was fine. That was fine. That was no. I don't have a problem with that. That's fine, you know. But it's the people that start shouting that you don't dare put who you support on Facebook anymore, that you are attacked. Not discussed, attacked. I don't know why people are like that. Hello, Nathan. Nathan's with us this evening. Hello, Nathan, who says, stupid question, got a colonoscopy tomorrow. The clean prep is another story. Any ideas how to induce it? I've had one, Nathan, round about this time last year. Haven't you got the powders? Have you got the powders, Nathan? You should have some powders. If you haven't got any powders and they're doing it tomorrow, they won't do it. So let me know if you've got powders and I'll tell you exactly what happens. OK? James says they seem to forget business doesn't sleep. Well, it doesn't, does it? You know, we've all got times to stick to and what have you. It's true. Ah, 10 to 6 in Leighton. As the Leighton is 10 till 6, that explains it. Yeah, they're allowed to open for 6 hours on a Sunday. I personally think, Alan, shops shouldn't be open on a Sunday. I think Sundays should be family days. But I am a bit old-fashioned now. I know that. I realise that. I personally think shops shouldn't be open on a Sunday. On the other hand, people want them open on the Sunday. If they didn't want them open, they wouldn't be going there. I actually think that this Sunday trading is a load of old twaddle. I really do. Either open or don't. All this, oh, you can open for 6 hours. What's all that about? What's all that about? I don't get that. Just open or don't open. One or the two. Matt says there are limited opening hours for stores over a certain size. Sainsburys Local was near me in Stockwell, was open till 11 p.m. Yeah, I think that's right as well. If it's as well like a small corner shop, like the Asian Boys and Girls, like with their corner shops, they can open all the time, can't they, I think? You know, it's a great shame. I did say a couple of shows ago, I think the big supermarkets have really damaged those little Asian shops that we've had for some years. You know, people came across here, set up little businesses, and it was all okay for a while. And then they allowed the big supermarkets to come in. And I think that damaged a lot of those little shops. And it was wonderful going in, you know, because I quite like a little bit of difference now and again. I don't want to go into saying, or Waitrose. I don't want to go into Waitrose all the time and see the same people doing the same thing. It's quite nice to go into a little place and you could have a chat with the boys and the girls in the little corner shops, couldn't you? Let's have a look there. Nathan says it was clean prep. Oh, really? Hang on a minute. I've not heard of that one, clean. Just a minute. Okay. Okay, so you got clean prep. It didn't do that to me. You're supposed to have, I think, 2 sachets... at night and 2 sachets in the morning, aren't you, or something like that. You'll have to get up for the morning ones, otherwise you might have an accident on the train because it's quite strong, that stuff. I wasn't sick at all. I tell you what you can do. You can put a little bit of orange juice or something in it to take. Is it the taste that makes you sick? Because it's not a very pleasant taste. Have you got the lemon one or the kind of just... It says tasteless, but it tastes actually very salty. Which one have you got? I have to have two of those every day. Not the really strong ones like you're having before your colonoscopy, but I have to have two sachets every morning. Otherwise, I stop going, and it's just a nightmare. Really, I'm sorry you're having so much trouble with that. If it's the tasteless ones, you can put a bit of orange juice or something else like that in to take the taste away, and you should be okay then. All right, fingers crossed. Alan said, "Always got a chip shop open there on a Sunday." Yeah, but is it proper chips, Alan? Or is it those cut-up things that they have in plastic bags? Not very nice, like what you get in kebab shops. There we are. All right. Now, what else have we got today? Let's go back to my story here. So, I went shopping. I was surprised to see all those people going in there at 10 to 4 in the afternoon, but there you go. Came back, had a cup of tea and some bickies, went for a sleep tonight. Just around about 4 o'clock I went to bed, got up again. Now, I did have my air conditioning on because I've got a wheel around air conditioning in the bedroom. I don't think it's working anymore. I'm not sure it's chucking out cold air like it used to. So I might have to replace that at some point. Mind you, I've had it about 15 years now. Oh, it's wonderful. Especially in the hot summer afternoon, you turn this thing on and it just cools the bedroom down. Then you go in there when you have your afternoon sleep, because I work nights, obviously, most of the time. You go in there for your afternoon sleep and you just open the door and the coolness is just so nice. So nice. Worth having one of those. Got back up again. Had my dinner. I had spaghetti arrabbiata with a little bit of cheese on top. Watched the rest of Benidorm. It's hilarious, Benidorm. Hilarious Benidorm. And we're talking about Mr. Wu. Now, Mr. Wu in Benidorm is this bloke who runs a Chinese restaurant. And the character is hilarious. This will bring me back to The Guardian again, actually. Let me see. Let me see if I can find the article. It's about a year ago. Mr. Wu Benidorm Guardian article. And then you'll hear about that liberal... Yeah, there it is. I've got it. Look at this. Here it is. Now, Mr. Wu is a hilarious character. An absolutely hilarious character in the TV series Benidorm. Runs a Chinese restaurant and he's always laughing. He's always telling really bad jokes and laughing. A bit like your dad. Always telling bad jokes and laughing. And he's part of the show. But The Guardian wrote, this was January last year, and it written by, who's the writer? He's probably someone who comes into the pub, I think. Sam Wollaston. And he says, which leaves me, oh God, Benidorm. It's been a while since I dropped into the Costa All-Inclusive. Maybe Benidorm not good in the meantime. I saw it was up for a national television awards. Anyway, I'm just going to go straight down to the Mr. Wu thing. Here we go. And there's a property auction where Joyce finds herself in a bidding war with a kind of 1970s national stereotype of a Chinese man, a Chinaman, I think they were called Mr. Wu. They may be rivals in the property market, but that doesn't stop Mr. Wu having a crack. Lucky cards, that's what I say. Ha ha. He says because Joyce plays her cards close to her chest, which Mr. Wu is staring at. Then he asks if she's a virgin. You're joking, she says. She's bound the rock more time than a lost jogger. No auction virgin. Then Mr. Wu starts to bid against Joyce for a finca with a potential, and she's not best pleased. I will never once again touch your pork balls again, she says to Mr. Wu. Has a restaurant near the beach. Of course he does. He's Chinese. To recap then, drinking, misunderstanding, farts, blowjobs, big bellies, big belly flops, boobs, innuendo, pork balls and a little light racism. I'm not so sure Benidorm did get good in the meantime. It would be easier to forgive if this stuff was coming out of your embarrassing uncle who never made it to the 1970s. In fact, that's what Benidorm is. Someone allowed your embarrassing uncle who never made it to the 70s to make a television show, which he did out of both ends. I mean, you know, why can't you just see the funny side of it? Why can't you just see the funny side of it? So there's your good example. of the Guardian, the very liberal Guardian, which no one reads anymore, I don't believe. James says, does Sticky Vicky impress you? She used to work on the Ibiza, didn't she? Sticky Vicky, yeah. Doing some very clever things with ping pong balls, I gather. Oh, Nathan, nope. All tonight with 4 hours with a 1 hour break. It's meant to be vanilla, but I've mixed it with lime, squash and everything. Not for sure why it hits my stomach. I'm sick. I wouldn't take anything else, Nathan. I don't think you should take anything else, mate. Just try and do what it says it's going to do. And then when you go tomorrow for your thing, you've got to tell them what happened last night when you were taking it. That this would have happened to people before, so they'll be able to tell you what's what. Perhaps ring them first. Have you got a long journey into a hospital sometime tomorrow? It might be an idea to ring them in the morning and say, you know, you've got this procedure. You've got a procedure this afternoon. You know, you've had the powder, but it's been chucking up on you all night. So, you know, before you go there, it might be an idea to give them a ring before you go there. All right? Because I'd hate you to go there and then you find that that it's not going to happen. Because that might be the case. I don't know how that works. I don't know. I do know when I did it and it was just awful. You know, you're dashing to the toilet every few minutes once it happens. And that lasts for a period of time. I suppose about an hour altogether, I suppose. And then it just stops. You know, you stop going. And then you go to the hospital. You know, all right. The actual operation, it's not an operation, the actual procedure isn't too bad, to be honest. All right, it's not too bad at all. It's nowhere near as bad as you think. I think probably having a camera down your throat would be a lot worse. Yeah, a lot worse. When I had it, I didn't have any sedation. I had no sedation or pain relief at all. I didn't want it. Which means, of course, you know, when the procedure is finished, it's finished. If you have sedation, you will be for a few hours and maybe feeling a bit sicky afterwards. And then you've got to, I don't think you can go home straight away. I was, as soon as they finished the procedure, I was out there in half an hour back in the car on the way home. Whereas if you have the sedation, if you're really worried about it, then have the sedation. But you won't leave the hospital or clinic, wherever you're going. You won't leave as quickly, unfortunately. You know, it'll go on a bit. All right. Okay. I think we're about done now, aren't we, boys and girls? Are we done this evening? Yeah, we're done. Okay, we're done. So any more messages, get them in nice and quickly. Let's just get rid of the phone number. That's gone now. There we are. Get that ready there. So many bits and pieces to remember. There we are. That's there. Can I just move that up there? Oh, hang on a minute. Sorry. No, one minute. Done something wrong. There we are. Now, where's that gone? Is my Union Jack gone? Let me just try and move something up. You can't see that, can you? That's better. So much to do, dear. Right, we'll go back to that. Is that right? There we are. There we are. Sorted. Going to do today's and... tomorrow's birthday as well, because there's no show tomorrow. That's the other thing I did tonight. Then I removed an oven. Now my oven broke the week before last, I think it was. The grill underneath the oven, it suddenly turned white where the grill was touching the oven. Something had broken on there. And it stopped working completely. And it actually snapped. The element on the grill snapped. Now, I would normally have something repaired. I'm not someone who replaces something just for the sake of it or just before you get the first time it goes wrong or anything like that. So, but this oven is about 25 years old now, so I think time for a replacement. So I removed the old oven today. Very, very clever. It's actually only 4 screws, and then you pull the whole thing out underneath the worktop. It's quite heavy, but I managed to get it outside the front, and I've just left it outside the front of my house, and where me and my mate will take that down the dump tomorrow. down the Bracknell Farm. I've got my new oven arriving tomorrow between 8:30 and 10:30 in the morning. And I'll install myself. It's actually very easy to install an electric oven. It's three wires, basically. And if you've already got one in there, then obviously you turn it off at the mains first. You remove the three wires that are on the oven. So you just leave the wire hanging there, chuck that oven out, get the new one in, connect the three wires up and push it back into position. Done. All done. It's ever so easy. It's outrageous. People charge £150 to install an oven. Seriously, it's three wires. And it's the same with if you've got an electric oven cooker slot in, you know, the whole thing. You know, I don't know what you call that, like a mobile thing. It's not really mobile, is it? You push the whole thing into position. That's three wires. Earth, neutral, and live. And you go from the power socket to the oven. Oh, actually, I don't know if you're allowed to do that. I'm not actually sure you're allowed to do that. I think you might. I think nowadays, I'm not sure if you might have to have someone actually install that properly for you. But it's ever so easy. It's really easy. I wouldn't muck about with gas. Oh, no. No, I wouldn't want to try DIY on gas. In fact, you're not allowed to anyway, are you? I'm sure you're not. Right, so we'll do the birthdays for today and tomorrow as well, as I'm not here tomorrow because I'm waiting for my new oven. Then we've got to take that down there. I've got to get some garden spray because I've got lily beetles. My lilies are growing and the lily beetles are out in force. Horrible little red things they are. And I caught two of them shagging on one of my lily plants. It was one on top of the other. It's disgusting. It's like a porn show out there in the garden today. Ghastly, dear, ghastly. Today's birthdays then, Chris Davis. Happy birthday, Chris. 26 years old today. Happy birthday, Chris. Mark Popperwell. I love your surname, Mark. Happy birthday to Mark. Nikki Hart is 41 years old today. Happy birthday, Nikki. The lovely Paul Martin, who was at the... Were you there last night? I think you were at the Central Station either Saturday or Friday this week. Didn't get a chance to talk to you, I don't think. I was a little bit busy. Is 53. Still younger than me, Paul. Happy birthday for you on this Sunday. And Monday's birthdays, boys and girls. So what's Monday? That'll be the 10th, wouldn't it? 1 minute, I've got to bring those up on another section. Monday's birthdays. If you're sending in any messages, I will read those out before we disappear this evening, OK? 9:10. Where's the 10th? There we are. How many have we got today? Oh, quite a few. Greg Bramwell. Greg Bramwell, happy birthday to you today, sir. Paul Knight. Hello, Paul. Paul Knight. It's Paul Knight's birthday today. Happy birthday, Paul. Christina Ewing. Oh, I love the name Ewing, Christina. Ewing from Dallas. Did I tell you I met Linda Gray from Dallas? Oh, yes. Sue Ellen, I spoke to her for about 20 seconds in the street once. Outside Wimbledon Theatre a couple of years ago. There's a video of me doing that, you know. It's there somewhere. Happy birthday, Christina. Happy birthday to Ummu Haki, 42 today. Martina McGarry is 53 today. Martina, I used to work with at British Telecom Directory Inquiries. It's funny, we had Jackie Veen's birthday a couple of days ago, didn't we? Today it's Martina, and we used to get on like a house on fire. I remember coming to your house once in Wimbledon. Or was it Rains Park, sort of along that? I think you were along that Merton. Was you along that Warple Road somewhere? A little bit further going back towards Rains Park. I think I came to your house once. And if I remember, you had a very long kitchen. I could see you standing there. Isn't that funny? That's like 30-odd years ago. Happy birthday, Martina. I hope you're very happy and all that. Wasn't that a boring job, eh? Director Inquiries. We hated it. We hated it. But British Telecom, they were a damn good company to work for, and I did quite well there. I became an engineer in the end, which I adored doing that job, being a British Telecom engineer. Absolutely loved it. Happy birthday, Martina. Arthur Harbariuk. Arthur Harbariuk. I hope I've got that right, Arthur. 22. You're young, aren't you? Happy birthday to you, Arthur. Hope I've got your surname right. I'm not very good with the foreign surnames, but I do my best, OK? Kaz Thomas. Happy birthday to Kaz on Monday. Noah. Noah is 40 today. Noah Adam Rokokowski, I think it is. 40 years old today. Happy birthday to you, sir. Drew Christie, happy birthday to Drew Christie, and John Hughes as well. They're all the birthdays today. Let's sing you a little song.
We are fighting the fake news.
No, we haven't done fake news today, have we? Never mind, I have this one. So many jingles to choose from, dear. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. Happy birthday. Happy birthday to you. All right? Have a lovely birthday, whatever you're doing. Whether it was on Sunday or Monday this week, I hope you have a nice, have had or are about to have a nice birthday, okay? Any more messages for me to read out before I disappear? Or is that it? No, I think we're done today. Really, honestly, good luck tomorrow, Nathan, with your colonoscopy. Nothing really to worry about too much, OK? I will say to you that. Nothing really to worry about. Time to disappear, boys and girls. Yes, indeed. Thank you very much for watching the show today. Sunday night. Now, tomorrow night, it's Monday night tomorrow. I will be, as always, hosting karaoke at the Central Station Bar in Wharfdale Road, King's Cross. Now, every Monday, we do get busy on Monday, OK? Starts at 8 o'clock and we're busy by 8:30. Get there early. If you want to sing, you've got to get those songs in by 9:30, 10 o'clock, because it just fills up with song requests. You cannot walk in at 11 o'clock and expect to sing. It's too late, OK? 8 till 11:30 is our karaoke tomorrow night, along with cheap drinks at Central Station Bar in Wharfdale Road, King's Cross. All right, that's it today. Enjoy the rest of your Sunday and sleep well if you're about to go to bed. Are you going to bed? Are you going to bed? Did you want me to sing you a little lullaby? Go to sleep. Go to maybe not. No, that'll probably keep you awake, wouldn't it? Have a nice sleep, and I'll see you again very soon. Bye-bye now.